Thanks, Pallavi. Good to be here. And it's a pretty packed audience, even after, I think, 3 hours of product management gyan. So, and right before lunch, as they would say. So I'm going to dive right into it. And we'll try to make it as interactive as possible. My name is Amit Somani. I've been doing product for over a decade now, and you know, with an engineering background prior to that. So let me start with a quick sort of quiz. There's a bunch of metrics here. I'm not going to read them out. I think the font should be good enough for people in the back to read it. I want people to tell me which of these do you think is a good metric. Can people read this? 100,000 MAUs in September, 20,000 DAUs with an average session time of 10 plus seconds, and so on and so forth. You know, net promoter score is now 55. Just shout out. Let's make it a little lively.
Shopper conversion is 6%.
Great. Anybody else?
It depends on the business.
Net promoter score?
Yeah. It depends also on the market. Like if shopper conversion, the rest of them are converting at 50%, you're converting at 6%, it's bad actually.
Okay. So that's not a good metric. What
exactly.
Is
it's,
good metric?
It's all relative.
It's all relative?
Contextual.
Cost of customer acquisition is reduced.
Cost of customer acquisition is reduced.
Okay. Number of Facebook shares.
Number of Facebook shares, good metric.
Has increased
30%. Okay. So in an ideal world, actually none of these are really good metrics. Right? And I think if people started alluding to some of the reasons why. One kind of very fundamental thing about what defines a good metric is actually, does it change the behavior of, you know, your development, your product management, in terms of what are you going to do depending on what the outcome of this metric is. So the very first thing is you've got to figure out, you know, like Yesdi was saying as well, and then, you know, whether it was MakeMyTrip or Google, you know, the data-obsessed companies and cultures, you will get, you know, not just thousands, tens of thousands, you know, hundreds of thousands of reports, and then all the raw data is also accessible to you. So it's very, very easy to start puking data and metrics all over, right? You can easily have, you know, 63,000 metrics, and I'm not kidding, right? Those of you are not somebody from Google here, I left many years ago. But so the very core thing is, you know, does it help you define what your behavior is going to be? So what are some of the challenges, including the metrics I showed earlier, right? One is that, you know, averages are not meaningful. This is one of the biggest mistakes when you think about metrics. So people tend to, you know, even the example of shopper conversion being 6%, you know, or, you know, average session time being, you know, 10 seconds. Average session time is less meaningful. At the very least, if you're going to take a metric which you want to be a very simplistic metric, you want to take medians, not averages. And again, it depends on what you're doing. If you're doing latency or time to download, you know, web page, or your time to install your app, or the time for activation, you know, you might look at the 90th percentile or the 10th percentile, right? Especially in India, latency is like a big problem, but certainly not an average. So almost any average metric kind of goes out of the door. Absolute metrics are useful, useless, right? Like the gentleman here pointed out in the yellow shirt, that, you know, 6% shopper conversion might be phenomenal if you are perhaps even in, you know, I don't work there, so I can talk about it, like let's say Flipkart or an e-commerce company, right? This is sort of unheard of to have high single-digit percentage conversion for an e-commerce company, but it might be terrible if you are. I'm not from the gaming business. It might be terrible if you're in gaming and your conversion metric is in-app purchase, right? Maybe you want it to be much higher than that. I don't know what the typical numbers are. So therefore, it's very, very important to have some kind of a benchmark that you're comparing to for where it's known. And for where it's not known, you need to have your own internal goals, right? So certainly, an absolute number by itself doesn't really make sense. The third one is similar, which is on blended metrics, right? So there was one of the metrics in there which said, you know, ARPU is $2. I'm not saying ARPU is a bad metric, but an absolute metric of, you know, ARPU being $2 is somewhat irrelevant. You have to have some context. You have to have some benchmark. You have to have some goal on the basis of which you're sort of defining that, right? So you have to segment it. And we'll look at what is a good metric, you know, in a little bit. Talk a little bit about, you know, there is data galore, there is information galore, so therefore it's easy to spit out metrics. The point oftentimes, and for, you know, how many of you are in startups? Like less than 10 people? Larger companies? More than 10 people? Okay, so, you know, maybe 70, 30 startups and larger companies. How many people know what a hippo is? Ravi knows. Ravi and I are only ones who've dealt. Highest paid person's opinion, right? So there are a lot of vanity metrics, right? That come about because, and even in a startup, you might have your investor who wants to know the number of downloads, even though Yazdi might say, who cares about how many downloads you have? You might have 10 million downloads, but how many people are actively using your thing every day or every month? And what's your daily active user population compared to your monthly active user population? But that won't get you a quote in the Economic Times, right? So you say, oh, I have 53 million downloads. And some of these were from 7 years ago, and nobody actually uses that anymore.
Can you please explain the averages part once again?
Sure. So let's take a simple example of something that we used to look at a lot at MakeMyTrip, and at Google, it's obsession at Google as well, which is latency, time to download. And I'm going back to the web world a little bit, right? So at Google for the homepage, google.com page, it was an internal company goal that it should never be for any user anywhere in the world, including India, Brazil, Russia, whatever, never be more than half a second, 500 milliseconds. That's the worst case, right? Now I could, but there are many users in countries like in the US or Japan or wherever, where you might be 100 milliseconds. And assume that the internet population, I'm talking 5 years ago, and even probably true today, although it's rapidly changing with the mobile, assume that the average for Google's homepage was 200 milliseconds. We'd be ecstatic, right? However, because I was in India and dealing with the Indian audiences, we were getting, for the Google homepage, 2 seconds, 3 seconds, which is unheard of, right, in the Google landscape, right? And certainly even at MakeMyTrip, in the early days, it was almost 10 plus seconds to get to the homepage or to get to flight search. But nobody would really look at that metric. But if you do the average, you might say, oh, I'm 7 seconds. But if you do the 90th percentile or the 10th percentile, depending on your scenario, in this case, slow is bad. And let's say that 90th percentile was 35 seconds. So maybe a user from Bhopal getting to the MakeMyTrip homepage or a YouTube video was taking 6 seconds for the first frame to play or for the flight, the first flight result to appear. That's disaster. You'll never see that user again. It's probably as bad as the crash, although if there is no choice, then people will still go to that. But we saw this a lot in YouTube, right? And we saw this a lot even at MakeMyTrip as latency improved. But if you just looked at the average metric, you'd be floating, right? Because you'd be like, oh, my target is 10 seconds or 6 seconds. And I'm doing 6 seconds. And hence, at least the median is a little more representative. But to depending on the metric, you should either take a median, you should take the 90th percentile or the 10th percentile and go after that. Okay. So very simply, this is my attempt at trying to say what should a good metric be, right? Because I think there's lots of people with different kinds of startups and companies, B2C, mobile, SaaS, etc. But here are some rules of thumb that as I thought about this presentation, so it has to be very, very simple and self-explanatory, right? You shouldn't have to, oftentimes people say, revenue per organic user, blah. Right, and you're like, okay, what is, you can get very, very complicated. It has to be very simple. I mean, it doesn't require whole lot of, explanation. It can't be absolute. We talked a little bit about this. It has to be relative to something, right? It could even be relative to just time. So it could be month on month, week on week, quarter on quarter, year on year. It could be relative to a benchmark, right? So if you're in the travel industry, you might look at, folks like, Booking.com or Expedia or MakeMyTrip or Ctrip or whatever and say relative to that, And what is known here is my conversion metric. I think you pointed this out earlier. The goal is really, really, really important. So if you look at all the lean startup movement and lean analytics, the one thing that is talked about a lot there, and we'll look at this very briefly, is there's an acronym called the one metric to track, right? So not only do you need to figure out what is your one metric to track, you need to figure out what is the goal for that metric? And it varies based on the stage of your product. It has to be granular. We did talk about this earlier, right? So for example, shopper conversion being 6%, even if it was right and the industry benchmark was low single digit percentage points and you were doing well, is not a great metric because it may not be granular enough. Because the shopper conversion for organic traffic, again, coming from the web world, so also a little bit prehistoric era. But shopper conversion for organic traffic will typically be far better than shopper conversion for paid traffic, which might be better than shopper conversion for SEO traffic, right? In the web world. Therefore, it is shopper conversion for what, right? Is it, again, blended shopper conversion is somewhat meaningless. even if you have it Q on Q or month on month. And if you take away one thing from this talk, right, which was that if it doesn't change your behavior, if it's not actionable immediately, like don't track that metric. Put it in the pile, put it on your dashboard or your internal dashboard, whether it's your VC that wants to look at it, your employees, or you know, or if you're in a big company, your other colleagues or your executives, right? So it has to be actionable. It has to change behavior. And it's not, a metric is not for the lifetime of a business or the lifetime of a product, right? It can evolve and you can pick a different metric as well. But maybe it's early days for a mobile app. It's all about the first engagement after the user downloads the app, right? Maybe that's the one metric, but you're seeing how many people activate the mobile app, how many people try to get that first moment or that first experience with the app. So this is what I think a good metric should be. And how do we sort of go there? The very first thing, and I think Yesdi covered this, I think some of the folks in the previous session talked about this as well. The very first thing is to, you know, define your business objective, right? What is it that you are trying to do? And how does that translate it into this metric? For what audience, right? So segment it, make it actionable, define it. Another trick that I've used over the years, I learned this at Google, which I thought was very, very useful, and I've used it a lot at MakeMyTrip and other some of these other startups I help and mentor, which is before you launch anything, whether it's a product or a feature, you have to define the predicted outcome of that thing. A week out, a month out, you know, a quarter out, depending on your this thing. I'm not a year out, right? Like in the near future, right? At best, I would say a quarter out. But at least a week out and a month out, if you had to pick two numbers, right? So you, let's say I was launching a new feature, like a hotel tonight kind of a feature, which saying last minute bookings for tonight only using a travel mobile app, like Hotel Tonight, like Make My Trip, whatever. Then I have to say, what percentage of my users will even try this, or what will the conversion be for this specific feature a month after launch or a week after launch? It doesn't matter, you know, whether you're, you know, initially whether you're right or wrong, right? That is how you're going to train your intuition. That's how you're going to train your gut. That's how you're going to go figure out the data. So it was mandated, you know, certainly at MakeMyTrip and even at Google, that before you launch anything, you had to publish to the entire company that I'm launching this thing, and I think this will be the metric a week from now. This will be the metric a month from now. So that forces a certain level of self discipline. So that's on the goal. Then it depends on the life stage of your product, right? So I'm guessing there's a lot of startups here. So some of you may be pre-product market fit. So in the early stages, nothing matters except, you know, at some level engagement, or I would even call it conversion if you're more a transactional kind of a business, right? Because it's not about scale, it's not about traffic, it's not about acquisition, it's nothing. It's just even if I could buy the 10,000 users that Yesdi is going to sell you for free or for cheap, right? Are they engaged? Are they using my product as it is intended, as what my thought process was, as what my product design was, or what my USP was? As you get to the early growth, then the source of traffic acquisition, the cohort or the segment of the customer becomes really, really important, right? Saying, okay, so if I could magically have 10, 100 people show up, to take a crude offline analogy, show up to my restaurant, eat the food, and they love it, that's great, but these are my friends and family, or have been, escorted for free to come have this meal at the Microsoft office, right? And so that's, one experiment. But what if I open the funnel, right, and start attracting people from different sources and different channels, and I run a Facebook ad campaign, and I run a, start getting indexed on SEO or doing paid marketing on the web? What happens then? And the metric may not just be the product metric. It might be the acquisition metric, right? But it is obviously relevant to product. Product and marketing sort of in that sense go hand in hand. So I'll have to figure out what is my conversion by source of traffic and how is that trending? What is the marginal cost of acquisition for that channel? So I might find that users that come installed from Twitter don't convert so well on an app like Zomato, whereas those that come from Facebook, where it was recommended by a friend, do really well. So it'll help you both with your marketing as well as with your product to try to figure out what audience to go after and is the value prop of the product connecting or not. And in the last stage, right, when you get to perhaps a Zynga or a MakeMyTrip or Google-like stage, then it lot becomes about, optimization, about, virality, about growth, about really fine-tuning that flywheel so you can really, really scale up, you know, kind of on your way to world domination, right? So in the so therefore, oftentimes I find people get really obsessed with trying to do too much optimization at the early stages on too many different metrics. You just need to pick one. Of course, you need to optimize. It's not like you don't. But you pick the one metric that is most relevant to your product or your value proposition and kind of optimize on that. I think I'm going to run out of time here. Pallavi's given me the signal. So just last 2 minutes. So these are just some, you know, good rules of thumb. This is very broad audience, very broad. But nonetheless, I thought I'll put a few out that at least I look at, depending on what it is, what kind of business you're in. So lifetime value should be 3x the cost of CAC. And I know Saran from Flipkart really well, but you know, maybe I'll catch him at lunch because you know the way people are spending money on the on customer acquisition in the e-commerce world, it looks like this is a useless metric. But for a startup, I can assure you this is a very, very relevant metric. You know, organic versus inorganic traffic, right? So even if it is the mobile world or it is the web world, you know, how many things are you getting just organic distribution, organic downloads, organic usage, and what is inorganic? So I think once you cross, and again, this is, you know, please take this with a grain of salt because it depends on the stage of your company. Conversion, we already said, you know, high single digit percentage point for most commerce kind of businesses is sort of a global benchmark, at least the ones that I've seen. And a net promoter score, which is actually one of the most underutilized metrics, at least in the Indian ecosystem that I see. But one of the most powerful metrics to help you with respect to, you know, repeat, retention, you know, implicitly, you know, virality and referral marketing, right? So people are willing to, and it's a very simple scale of 1 to 10. You just give, you can ask for that question anytime to the user.
What does it mean?
Oh, sorry. So net promoter score is basically, it's a mathematical formula which asks a user, would you refer my product or service to your friends or family or whoever? On a scale of 0 to 10, you give them a rating. And the number is computed as if you get 9 or 10, you're a promoter, meaning that customer is a promoter of your business or your service or your app or your product. And if it's less than 7, so if it's 7 or 8 is neutral, and 0 to 6 is a detractor, right? Or a, so you do promoters less detractors, you know, divided by the population, right? So some of the best businesses in the world, you know, like Apple or a Nike or American Express have net promoter scores almost touching 80%. Amazon.com actually is in the e-commerce world, globally across all businesses, is the highest net promoter score. So I think even more than 50% would be phenomenal, but you know, you guys are an aspirational bunch, so you should aim for higher. But like I said, Amazon, Apple, you know, Nike, these are all touching 80%, which is that 8 out of 10 people would give them a 9 or 10 on 10 for being willing to, you know, to be to refer their product to somebody else, right? And with, you know, little to no detractors. So anyway, it's a very simple metric. You begin to see it now in a few e-commerce sites in India. And lastly, I know Pallavi is going to just throw me out of here now, but it you eventually rinse and repeat, right? So you pick a metric relevant to your stage of company. You figure out, it's multiple S curves, right? So you know what you have in version one, as you optimize it, you get to the next level, you're kind of beginning to plateau out, then you go off to the next one. And it might be the same metric, but same metric, you know, you did really well on conversion, you get to, you know, 4-5% conversion, shopper conversion, organic traffic, you know, self-acquired, whatever. But now you're opening up the floodgates of marketing, you're beginning to do, you know, some kind of online marketing or even offline marketing. And then now you need to hold conversion and not have it drop too much as you go to the next phase and so forth. So you pick your metric, iterate, and I think that's it.